God, I just pray that you may open up our ears and our hearts to receive your words, O Lord, and may it plant seeds in our lives that may sprout out fruit, O Lord. I may pray, Lord, that you may be with each individual in this room, their different contemplations and the different prayers of their heart, O Lord, and I just pray that you may teach them how to pray and come before you. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be holy and pleasing to you. May your gospel be preached, and may your spirit work in our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, there's this one Bible verse that has been ringing in my head over and over again, and I've just been constantly coming to it, and it comes from 1 Thessalonians 5:16 to 18, and it reads this way: Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. And I've been meditating on this, you know. We wrote it on our family's Christmas card, and it sounds really nice when reading it, right? Oh, like, rejoice always, give thanks, you know, pray continually. And it sounds simple enough to remember, right? Who doesn't want more joy or thankfulness in their life? And even the idea of praying is not really that offensive in our world. I mean, we even non-religious people, they can respect it. It's kind of like a universal sign for caring for someone. We can all use more prayer. Sure, we all love to do it, but it's often easier said than done, right? But Apostle Paul is reminding us that this is God's will for us in Christ, is what he desires for us, his design for us, his command for us. And as I was looking at this verse, you know, the pray continually kind of punched me in the face because, I mean, out of all these things, right? I mean, rejoicing always, like, okay, I get it, you know. I try to do it, but it's not something I have full control over. I mean, of course, we can say it, we can proclaim it, we can strive to do it and understand that's what we have in God. Therefore, we can choose to be joyful in one sense, at least in an eternal sense. But practically feeling, sometimes speaking, it kind of feels out of our control. Same thing with giving thanks, right? We can say thank you 1,000 times. And of course, words do have power to change our hearts. So we say it regardless of how we feel. But I realize that the glue to all this of thankfulness and rejoicing and all this is often held together by this praying continually. They need to come together because it's the place where all those other things are harvested. It's a place where God chooses to do the work in our lives. And it's a place that we're continually called to rest in. You know, prayer is kind of like a greenhouse for things. I mean, there's always seasons in our life, right? I mean, we have seasons of joy. We have seasons of hardship. We have seasons when everything's going right. We have seasons when every little thing annoys us like crazy. There's seasons in our life. Same thing in the world, right? There's different seasons, but a greenhouse is a place where our souls can find rest, growth, and comfort all year around. It's a place where you can appreciate the beauties that come out of life all year around. And let me tell you, I mean, you can believe in God. You can know all His truths. You can read the Bible front and back, and you can know all the promises that He has. But if we're not praying, those truths will not be consistently growing in every season of your life. And chances are you'll find yourself depending on yourself. You'll find yourself in a moment of anxiety or fear or different emotions that go up and down. And to be honest, you know, I found myself lacking in this so much. I mean, even going through leadership training with some of our potential elders that we'll be introducing in the next few weeks, you know, they all shared the same. I mean, we've done a lot of reading books. We've read through the Bible, some people more than once. But this thing called prayer was like universally, we're like, oh, yeah, I struggle with that. And, you know, it gives me some kind of comfort because that's what the disciples actually struggled with, too. If you guys remember back in the Garden of Gethsemane, Christ is like, please pray with me, watch and pray, but they all fall asleep. It's like me, every time I go to prayer, like, it's like, oh, man, I got to pray, you know. And so in one sense, you know, Jesus is not rebuking us for not praying, but he sees, when he sees us not praying, you know what it's kind of like? I mean, maybe when we grow up and our kids are going through more things, it's like watching your kids go through something. You know that they're struggling with something at school. You know that there's so much things that are going on in their heart, and you're just looking at them like please just come to me. But they're just like, no, I don't want to. I'll deal with it myself. In one sense, it could be healthy, but in another sense, they could make a lot of unwise decisions. And I feel that struggle. I mean, I preach all the time, every week, right? I preach about having joy in Christ. I say let's be thankful in Christ all the time of what God has done for us. I've read through the Bible many times now. But prayer has always been lacking. I mean, I pray, don't get me wrong. I have almost all of you guys on my prayer list. But the thing is, you know, I do it like a to-do list. Like, really, I look at it, I'm like, check one, prayer, check two. Like, I literally pray like that. And then I'll look at it again. I'll look at the list again, and I'll pray again. And I'll do that for my own life. Even for my kids, I check them off. Like, you know, hopefully they grow up all right. Like, they're not crazy. And you know, I'm almost embarrassed to admit it, because I grew up with a lot of mentors and pastors who would often say that they'd go up to mountains for days and spend time with God in prayer. I have mentors that they say that they fast before every sermon they preach. And I'm like looking at my life like, oh, I have no business in ministry. So honestly, I think this prayer, this whole sermon series is kind of like my coming to you guys asking for prayer for prayer. But what makes prayer difficult is not the action itself. I mean, over the next few weeks, we're going to learn that prayer is actually really simple to do. But it's so hard to do it all the time. I mean, there's seasons when I was energetic for prayer, but there are other seasons where, well, I don't know why, it's hard to do. But prayer at the end of the day is a simple conversation with God. I mean, at the fundamental basics of what it is, it's continually coming to him, spending time with him, where we let him know what's going on in our lives. We invite him to celebrate in our blessings, as well as invite him to mourn together in our hardships. It's an act of depending on God, where we worship him, letting him know that we acknowledge that he is in our lives, and we acknowledge that he actually has the power to do something. A prayer life is a relational life with God, and like all relationships, it comes with different seasons. Sometimes there's passion, sometimes it's just commitment where it requires effort. And the process of keeping up with this relationship, there's always so many distractions, right? Oh my gosh, man. Like I come up with 101 different things that come up in my mind. Like even in the moment of prayer, I'll think of things to do and I'll go do them and then forget to pray again. I don't know if you guys ever done that. I do that a lot. I mean, we have our kids, we have our work, we have our to-do lists, we have our hobbies. And even ministry itself can stop us from prayer. But what we often don't realize is that our relationship with God in this moment of prayer is not in competition with all those other things. If we really understand the type of relationship we have with God, I mean, God is not a nagging boyfriend or girlfriend or spouse that's like, give me attention, talk to me all the time. Like, he's not that nagging type of person. But in fact, he calls us our Father. He actually says we're co-workers, someone who works with us in everything. You know, when our relationship with God is upheld through prayer, it doesn't take away from the other things. It actually enables them. It gives it power. It keeps